inaugural lecture for the academic year 2017 and 18, Mr. Dushyant Dave, senior advocate in the Supreme Court of India and former president of the Supreme Court Bar Association, will be delivering a talk on independence of judiciary and judicial appointments. Mr. Dave is someone who is known for taking courageous stances to uphold the constitutional values. His field of practice is very diverse, ranges from administrative law, constitutional law, civil law, and has also done substantial work in arbitration law. He is also known for taking up major issues in the interest of legal profession, and so we are proud to welcome him as our first guest speaker for this academy. I would leave the dais to you, sir.
Your stage is quite technology savvy, and I'm technology challenged. Morning, everybody. Vice Chancellor, the distinguished professors, and student friends, it gives me a great privilege to be here before you today. It's one of the youngest campuses of law in this country, and yet its contribution in last few years has been immense. It has produced some of the most outstanding young lawyers whom I have come across from many law firms, and you know, few in litigations as well. So it's really heartening to be here at this institution. I congratulate the Vice Chancellor and the faculty for this, and I compliment the students for taking up the studies of law in a very serious manner in this institution. I must confess, when I went to law school, those 3 years, I spent almost all 3 years in a canteen outside the college. And I rarely attended the classes, except maybe one or two teachers who interested me. So I was not, like you, a serious student. Even in my 4 years of college, I don't think I went to class for more than 20 days. So academics is something. But I fruitfully invested those years, 7 years. I read a lot. Almost every literature in the world, I read those 7 years. And that's something what really helped me in my legal profession, ultimately. I congratulate the organizing committee and young man Thakkar for this series of lectures on constitutionalism, a subject which is much less understood and even less appreciated. I must tell you something, that when he sent me the email on 21st of March, at about 11:30, I received it, and my only technology relationship is my mobile. So everything is on my mobile. I have never opened a computer, I have never opened internet, and I have never Googled anything. I am actually challenged. I am afraid. And if I have to plug in a stereo system, I tell my wife to do it, and she always tells me it's because you are afraid of being electrocuted and you don't mind if your wife is electrocuted. Within an hour I accepted his invitation, because it was really a very interesting, heartening rather, to realize that the organizing committee had taken up the subject of constitutionalism. One of the biggest challenges for this country is complete absence for love for constitution. And there is no institution, including the judiciary, which really works under the constitution. I think everything that's happening in this country is dehors the constitution. So this debate is a very interesting debate, and I'm really happy to be here before you. Independence of judiciary and judicial appointments. I think independence, to my mind, is a myth. It's not a reality. But anyway, let me place my thoughts before you. Modern thoughts on politico-legal principles started with Austin, declaring that law is the command of the sovereign, to Montesquieu, giving us the theory of separation of powers, and ending with Roscoe Pound, who had advocated shifting the center of gravity in legal system from statute law to judge-made law. Our constitution is broadly based on theory of separation of power, and therefore what Montesquieu once said assumes great importance on independence of judiciary. There is no liberty, he said, I quote him, there is no liberty where judicial power is not separated from both legislative and executive power. If judicial and legislative powers are not separated, power over life and liberty of citizens would be arbitrary, because the judge would also be a legislator. If it were not separated from the executive power, the judge would have the strength of an oppressor, unquote. That is why Andrew Jackson, former president of the United States, once beautifully put, and he said, I quote, all the rights secured to the citizens under the Constitution are worth nothing and mere bubble, except guaranteed to them by an independent and virtuous judiciary. Our Supreme Court has proved this statement to be so true when, far from being independent and virtuous, it delivered the judgment in the additional district magistrate Jabalpur versus Shivkant Shukla, popularly known as ADM Jabalpur's case, during the prevailing emergency in 1976. It declared that the enforcement of fundamental rights, including the right to move any court for their enforcement, could be suspended under the presidential order of June 27, 1975, and Section 16A9 of the MISA, introduced by Act 14 of 1976 Act. Chief Justice Ray was joined by Justice Begg and two of the former future Chief Justices then, Justice Chandrachud and Justice Bhagwati, who is unfortunately revered across in this country, in giving the darkest of all judgments in the history of Supreme Court. While Justice H.R. Khanna stood up for the citizens, and in one of the most powerful dissents, and if you have not read that dissent, I would strongly recommend you read that dissent. I'm sure some of you have done it. He upheld the right of citizens to maintain habeas corpus before the High Court under Article 226, holding that, and I quote, rule of law is the antithesis of arbitrariness. Rule of law is the accepted norm for all civil societies. A fortiori, it would follow that under the rule of law, it's not permissible to deprive a person of his life or personal liberty without the authority of law, unquote. He said, law is a norm limiting the application of power by the government over the citizen or citizens over their fellows. He accordingly upheld the right of citizens to move the high courts seeking writs in the nature of habeas corpus even during emergency. This unfortunate and retrograde judgment of the Supreme Court underscores the need for a truly independent judiciary in this country and for ensuring right judicial appointments to secure that. What do we understand by judicial independence? On the first blush, it is fair, impartial, and honest adjudication guided by commitment to justice and expression of justice in law. But to ensure this, judges must be free to decide questions of law and fact without threat of retaliation, physically, financially, and occupationally. It is equally important that judicial decisions are not upturned or denied implementation surreptitiously or arbitrarily by the legislature or the executive, which is quite often in India. Judicial independence is one of the hallmarks of India's constitutionalism, although it takes different forms, though not absolute, but essential for good administration of justice. The basic form is party detachment, which requires that a judge not be related to the parties before the court, nor be in any way under their control or influence. This prevents threats to impartiality, such as bribery and close kinship between judges and litigants, but cannot prevent subtle violations, such as cultural bias, ideological sympathy, etc. Another form is individual autonomy, which requires the judge to be beyond constraint by collegial and institutional pressures and must decide by individual conscience and responsibility. More serious form of judicial independence is political insularity, which requires judiciary to be independent from popularly controlled governmental institutions. Political insularity is absolutely essential for pursuit of justice, that is, to do what is right and not what is popular, what is happening today in the country. And I'll give you an example of a judgment, just to go off my, that one young man belonging to a minority community was murdered in 2014, post Mr. Modi's election. Because somebody had posted a photograph, wrong photograph of Shivaji Maharaj on the Facebook. Now that was really done mischievously by somebody. Anyway, a call was given to attack the minority community members, and the crowd came and this young man was killed. The murderers were caught right there. The trial court refused bail to the murderers. The High Court, and unfortunately a lady judge of the High Court, who's a senior judge of the Bombay High Court, Justice Bhatkar, Mrs. Bhatkar, she releases the accused on bail, which is unprecedented, by stating this: yes, the accused were found at the place of occurrence. Yes, their blood-stained clothes were found. Yes, the weapons that they had used have been recovered. Their motorcycles were found. Yes, there are two witnesses, eyewitnesses, including a head constable of police. But then she says in the next sentence, since the victim belonged to a minority community, I give bail to the accused. Now this is something which is so shocking. I am appearing in Supreme Court for the Muslim organizations free of charge to assail that order. But it really sends shockwaves to us, and this is happening time and again. It has happened in Gujarat in large number of cases. It happened during the Sikh riot cases. I have defended many Sikh victims, you know, free of charge throughout. And I can tell you that the kind of approach that judiciary had, even to 1984 victims, and in 1984 almost 10,000 people were killed on a completely wrong pretext. Now, as against that, I cited, you know, this decision to the judges of the Supreme Court the other day, that post 9/11, where more than 3,000 people were slaughtered in America, it was a grave provocation. I mean, if Mrs. Gandhi's killing was a provocation or Godhra train burning was a provocation, 9/11 was a greater provocation. And two Indians were attacked, a Sikh in Arizona and a Gujarati Patel in Florida. In both cases, the murderers were executed. But it's interesting, the Gujarati Patel was sitting with a Gujarati Muslim boy in the store where he was shot dead. The murderer, when he filed appeal to the federal court, he filed an affidavit of the Gujarati Muslim boy in his support, saying that the murder was because of the sudden provocation on account of 9/11. He has a remorse in his heart, he feels sorry, and therefore his death sentence should be converted into life. The federal judge dismissed the appeal with one sentence, and that tells you how good the judicial system is. He said, this country will not tolerate hate crimes. Now this is where we are seriously missing in an independent judiciary, and this is what really is troubling me the most. This is in tune with separation of powers doctrine, which enables judiciary to be a balancing force within governance, checking abuse of power by legislature and executive. In a country like India, where government is the single biggest litigant in cases involving citizens' rights, this insularity assumes great significance. The Supreme Court maintained political insularity scrupulously in the 50s and 60s. In the 70s and 80s, this was seriously eroded due to ideological considerations. Judges like Bhagwati, judges like Krishnayyar, judges like Chinnappa Reddy, they all were completely ideologically motivated. Outstanding judges. Absolutely, their intellectual level was way ahead of any of the current judges. But they were so ideologically affected by Mrs. Gandhi that in their ideological pursuit, the justice was delivered with the completely colored, you know, approach, which is not really what judges are supposed to do. Since the 90s, Erosion of judicial independence and absence of political insularity is on account of willingness of judges to do what is popular rather than what is right. Of course, judiciary has many like Justice Khanna, but institutional approach requires a serious rethinking. One of the main factors eroding judicial independence on account of prevailing politics is, of course, the process of appointments. Article 124 and 217 relating to appointment of judges of Supreme Court and High Courts require the President to make appointments after consultation with the Chief Justice of India or other judges of the Supreme Court or the Governor of the State and the Chief Justice of the High Court as the case may be. The emphasis was on the expression consultation. Dr. Ambedkar articulated this view on 24th May 1949 while debating Article 103, now 124, and he said, I quote, and that man, I can tell you, was centuries ahead of times. Centuries, not 10, 20, 50 years. I mean, that man was amazing. On the last day, he was asked the question, will India retain democracy? And he said that if there is a landslide, there is every possibility India will retain democracy in form, but will lose it in fact. What is happening today? Look at the prophetic words of the man. I mean, he was absolutely amazing. He also quotes Burke somewhere else and says that India is one of the few, perhaps the only country in the world where bhakti in politics is extremely prevalent. And he says, bhakti is good for soul searching, but bhakti in politics will definitely lead to dictatorship. Now, this is the man, you know, he is talking on, I think it was on 25th November 1949. Look at his, you know, thinking. Now see what he says here on the power of appointment. It seems to me, in the circumstances in which we live today, where the sense of responsibility has not grown to the same extent to which we find in the United States, it has still not grown according to me. It would be dangerous to leave the appointments to be made by the President without any kind of reservation or limitation. That is to say, merely on the advice of the executive of the day. Similarly, it seems to me that to make every appointment which the executive wishes to make subject to concurrence of the legislature is also not a very suitable provision. Apart from its being cumbersome, it also involves the possibility of the appointment being influenced by political pressure and political considerations. The draft article therefore steers a middle course. It does not make the President the supreme and the absolute authority in the matter of making appointments. It does not also import the influence of legislature. The provision in the article is that there should be consultation of persons who are ex hypothesi, well qualified to give proper advice in matters of this sort. And my judgment is that this sort of provision may be regarded as sufficient for the moment. Why did he say that? Consultation with the Chief Justice. Because amendment was sought by more than one member that please replace the word consultation with concurrence, which is what the second judge's judgment has done. And it was debated. He expressly rejected amendments which sought to replace the words consultation with concurrence, mooted by some members, by stating as under. Now look at his answer and see what the Supreme Court has ended doing, which is proving to be so right. I quote, with regard to the question of concurrence of the Chief Justice, it seems to me that those who advocate that proposition seem to rely implicitly both on the impartiality of the Chief Justice and the soundness of his judgment. I personally feel no doubt that the Chief Justice is a very eminent person. But after all, the Chief Justice is a man with all the failings. All the sentiments and all the prejudices which we common people have. And I think to allow the Chief Justice practically a veto upon the appointment of judges is really to transfer the authority to the Chief Justice, which we are not prepared to waste in the President or the government of the day. I therefore think that this is a dangerous proposition. Now imagine the second judge's judgment, which you must have read in 1992, has actually used now the word concurrence, that concurrence of the Chief Justice. And they added to the Chief Justice this collegium, something absolutely funny. they expanded it. And the experience from 1992, I can tell you, I mean, I've been now a lawyer for 39 years, this is the 40th year. Experience shows, at least I can speak very clearly, I know of hundreds of cases, that the assumption of power by the judiciary to appoint judges has proved to be more disastrous than executive ever exercised it. So you have large number of outstanding judges who are not being, you know, promoted. Those who have something against the government in power, or the government perceives it to be against them, are being, you know, completely denied promotion. Even on judgments, Justice Patel, who is now number two judge in Karnataka, is a 2001 appointee. Last five justices who were appointed to Supreme Court few months ago are all junior to him. Patel is a man of outstanding integrity, commitment to law, and sincerity unparalleled. But he's no nonsense. His fault that in Ishrat Jahan's encounter case, he ordered a special investigation team. Take Chief Justice Joseph of Uttarakhand, one of the most outstanding minds in the country, legal minds today. Very, very upright judge. But he's not being brought to Supreme Court. Why? Because he made the mistake of, quashing the presidential proclamation to dissolve the Uttarakhand Assembly. Now, I mean, is this how we are going to really, and this is the collegium which says that we have taken away the power from the executive to appoint because we want to make good appointments, is party to, and these are a few examples. I know of hundreds in last 30 years, hundreds. So it's really something terrible. But Ambedkar unfortunately believed, and I would say to that extent, he was a too good a man. He said, and I quote, that the relation between the executive and judiciary are so separate and distinct that the executive has hardly any chance of influencing the judgment of the judiciary, unquote. Post-independence, at least post-70s, events have shown how utopian were beliefs of Dr. Ambedkar. The three judgments of the Supreme Court in judges' appointment cases, particularly the second one under which judiciary wrested the control of appointments to the Supreme Court and the high courts, by substituting the word consultation with concurrence, has left much to be desired in selection and appointments. If judges felt that constitutional mechanism given by our wise constitutional makers was insufficient in securing independence of judiciary, the solution attempted by judges has proved to be even more unsatisfactory. Experience has shown that executive is having a huge say in appointment and transfer of judges post-1992. Executive arbitrariness is now replaced or combined with judicial nepotism in the process. As a result, large number of good lawyers have missed being appointed to the high courts and the Supreme Court. For example, Mr. Gopal Subramaniam, one of the most outstanding lawyers that I've met in my life. He would have been an asset to the Supreme Court, like Justice Nariman and Justice Nageshwar Rao. Absolute asset. But he was denied because by the time his proclamation was to be made, Modi government had come in and they perceived him to be against their government or their philosophy or whatever. Now, what a loss. A man who is earning into, you know, tens and tens of crores of rupees is willing to sacrifice all that practice and become a judge, virtually getting nothing, pittance, you know, compared to his earnings. He is willing to give that sacrifice for 10 years. He would have been really responsible in laying down some of the best law, protecting citizens, as Nariman is doing today. You see his judgment after judgment that Nariman is churning out. Outstanding, absolutely. Totally pro-citizens judge. You show him the law and he is with you. He doesn't bother a damn whether government is there or not. Only he could have ordered that the demolition of Babri Masjid, the charge of conspiracy must be faced by top BJP leaders including Mr. Advani. For 20 years the case was languishing. And his own senior appeared, Mr. Venugopal, and he tried hard to deflect the matter so that it goes before another bench post. And he said, nothing doing. I won't even give you a day's time. So, you know, that's the kind of commitment, that's the kind of love for constitution that a judge must have, which likes of Justice Nariman reflect very beautifully. Equally, a large number of good judges in the high courts have suffered on account of the same by not getting promotions or being transferred out. Political voice has a great influence in the decisions of the collegium, be it high court or supreme court, in a subtle way. Merit, which was supposed to be the basis for selection as repeatedly emphasized in the second judge's case, has been completely overlooked. What counts are factors like seniority and proximity of candidates to members of the collegium or being perceived to be pro or anti-government. The NJSC judgment of the Constitution bench headed by current Chief Justice Kerr has made the situation worse rather than clear the clouds. Recent apprehensions by Justice Chalmeshwar and Justice Gogoi in a powerful, separate but concurring judgment in the case of Justice Karnan's case are clear eye-opener. They have said, and I quote, "We are only sad to point out that apart from the embarrassment that this entire episode has caused to the Indian judiciary, there are various other instances, mercifully which are less known to the public, of conduct of some of the members of the judiciary which certainly could cause some embarrassment to the system." And I can tell you some of those examples are gross. Gross. Including charges of homosexuality and abuse of class 4 staff members. No action. I distinctly remember having discussed Justice Karnan's case with Chief Justice Balakrishnan on more than one occasion when he was additional judge, and yet he was confirmed. So it's really very difficult. Some of us, there are very few of us who really would take up these, you know, this kind of this kind of burden on ourselves at the cost of our practice to, you know, ensure that the system really remains within check. We go often to the Chief Justice and complain to him about particular judges, but nothing happens. Nothing happens. I have shown judgments of Supreme Court which are completely, I mean, on the face of it, look procured. On the face of it. And I have shown it to the judges, and judges have refused to even review those despite the knowledge, because they protect each other. They protect each other. In one case which was actually pending before Justice Chauhan's bench, and the rule is that if a case is pending for final hearing before a bench, it can never be taken to another bench. It was grabbed by another bench in the garb of being similar to some third matter which was not similar, which had no connection. After it was grabbed, he says that yes, these are not too similar and therefore I detach them. After detaching, he decides that case and gives a 2000 crore land in Navi Mumbai for 30 crores of rupees to someone. And I didn't appear in the case, but this case was discussed in the canteen when I was having coffee just after it was decided by the lawyers who appeared, who were very disturbed. And I immediately shot off a letter to the judges and I said, "You please take action. This is unacceptable." Every propriety was breached in that case. But no, because they, you know, the judges have this very funny notion that if we expose wrongdoing in the judicial system, it will reflect on the system as a whole. Little do they realize, and that is why I argued, you must have perhaps, I don't know whether you read it or not, and somebody made a brilliant cartoon on it. I argued before the NJSC bench of 5 judges, and I openly challenged them that you wear burqas and walk in the corridor of every court in the country and you will know what your reputation is. In open court I argued, full court. And somebody made a brilliant cartoon. Google it and see it. It's a lovely cartoon somebody, I mean, very thoughtfully, you know, made. So, you know, but nothing happened. Justice Chalmeshwar and Justice Gogoi further say, "The framers of the Constitution were people of a great sense of patriotism and maturity, men and women who maintained high standards of civic morality. Obviously, they expected those who are to be chosen for the higher constitutional offices or to be appointed to public service would be chosen by assessing their suitability, efficiency and integrity by employing appropriate standards. Today there are no standards, believe you me. You just have to, you know, if you are a lawyer in High Court, you have to be in good books of the first three judges. Maybe, you know, maybe have a social contact with them, maybe wish them on their birthdays with some nice gifts, and soon you'll find your name, you know, on the list for recommended for High Court judgeship. Or if you are a High Court judge and you are aspiring to go to Supreme Court, more often than not it happens that when a Supreme Court judge is coming, these judges stand at the airport just below the ladder of the aircraft with bouquets and receive them. Now look at this. When Chief Justice Chagla was Chief Justice of Bombay High Court and Chief Justice Gajendra Gadkar was going to Bombay, he sent a message that I would like to meet you, so please do call on me. And Gajendra Gadkar wrote a letter back to him and said that it is during the office hours, court hours. I cannot come. I will not come. Now those are the standards that, you know, people had. Those are the standards that people had. But today, I mean, it is. I see it so often because I travel quite extensively. It is so sad to see these judges and chief justices standing, you know, at airports to receive Supreme Court judges. And I can tell you, at least two judges, two chief justices, Justice Jagannatha Rao from Andhra, top class judge, and one more judge were actually penalized because they did not receive the Chief Justices of India when they went there, or judges of Supreme Court when they went. I think Jagannatha Rao was in Kerala and he didn't receive Justice Verma, otherwise a good man. So, you know, this is what collegium system is. If there is one thing which is singularly missing there, it is merit. It is merit. So, there cannot be greater indictment of the existing appointment process than these words by Justice Chalmeshwar and Justice Gogoi. Please do read this dissent. I mean, it's not dissent, separate opinion in Karnan's case. It's interesting that the Constituent Assembly rejected two amendments to bring Article 40A and 102A of the Constitution, which were as under. This is important because, you know, the separation of judiciary, there were two articles proposed, I think both by Kanayalal Munshi, one of the greatest, you know, lawyers, authors, academicians, Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan's founder, great man, and his books in Gujarati literature are absolutely classic. He is the Shakespeare of Gujarati literature. Article 40A, there shall be complete separation of powers as between principal organs of the state, namely legislature, executive and the judicial. Article 102A, which was also proposed, subject to this constitution, the judiciary in India shall be completely separate from the wholly independent of the executive and the legislature. Both were opposed by Ambedkar, who felt that Article 39A, presently Article 50 of the directive principles, was sufficient to safeguard. Article 50 reads, separation of judiciary from executive. The state shall take steps to separate the judiciary from the executive in the public services of the state. Constitutional provisions for subordinate judiciary under Article 235 and related provisions attempt at such independence. And I can tell you, the appointments of district judges in some of the high courts, and high court judges are, you know, heading the panels for selection of subordinate judges with Public Service Commission, are far from satisfactory. Far from satisfactory. And sometimes I just appeared for the Gujarat High Court in a case where number one candidate on the list, selection list, was not appointed, while everybody else was appointed. And I considered the case. I told the Secretary General of the High Court, I said, you inform the Chief Justice that if they want me to appear, I will appear, but I will concede. And I conceded. Justice Chalmeshwar was mildly surprised. So he said, why? I said, I know how these appointment process took place. So it sends extremely disturbing, you know, signals to what we see. Provisions providing security of tenure Article 124.2 and 217.1, protecting salaries, allowances, preventing discussion in parliament or legislatures on conduct of judges. Power of contempt of court under 129 and 215, together with provisions for impeachment requiring sufficient majority, provide ostensible protective umbrella to secure independence of judiciary. But judiciary is dependent on the executive for enforcement of its orders, thus limiting its independence in one sense. In India, large number of judgments of the courts have been upturned by legislative acts in the garb of legislative supremacy. Post-retirement positions offered to judges is again a very big lure offered by the executive, eroding independence of judges. Appointments of judges as Speaker of Parliament or as Governor of a state, besides offering hundreds of statutory positions, can easily influence judiciary's decisions. I have written openly in an article that Justices Sadasivam and Justice Chauhan, who decided Mr. Amit Shah's case, and to my mind on law wrongly, have both, one has been offered governorship, the other has been offered chairmanship of the Law Commission of India. So, I mean, it's so obvious, but it's happening. There are hundreds of statutory tribunals where only those judges will be appointed who have, you know, fallen in line with the government. Any government, be it Congress, BJP, it has nothing to do with the political party. But this is how the executive controls. What you have to understand is, how is independence of judiciary going to be achieved with all these, you know, appointments of judges? The tribunalization of administration of justice is one extremely powerful weapon that executive has resorted to in undermining the judiciary. More and more areas of law are being slowly carved out of judiciary's reach. Parliament and legislatures are increasingly resorting to Article 323A and 323B for appointing administrative and other tribunals. Almost every economic activity and related disputes have been taken away from the judiciary. The appointments to these tribunals and their functioning have left much to be desired. These tribunals are often not judicious in their approach. Now, just take, for example, you know, company law. The entire company law work has now been transferred to this National Company Law Tribunal. And I can tell you, the functioning is so funny, it's really amazing. You have many other tribunals, take for example, for the monopolies or unfair trade practices tribunal. I mean, these tribunals have really no concept of what the law is. They don't want to make an effort as to what to understand, much less to develop the law or to lay down the jurisprudence. Nothing of that sort is really happening. All these tribunals, income tax tribunals, excise customs tribunal, disaster in Delhi, complete disaster. So all these tribunals, I don't know what they will end up doing. For years, company law board was manned by an acting chairman who was not even a lawyer. And he was so, you know, so close to the minister's concern for a long time that he remained there for a long time. And he was very powerful and he was so bright that he could, he, with the same set of facts, he could give two judgments and both would look convincing. So you can imagine what he was doing. That's what it is. Munshi, in fact, spoke about tribunalization of judiciary, justice, on 23rd May 49, and he said, "Now, if I may remind the House, the doctrine of separation of power, which was originally put forward by Montesquieu in the middle of the 18th century, was the basis on which the Constitution of the United States was framed. But last 150 years of experience has shown that doctrine of separation of powers cannot be maintained in a modern state. Today, we find the executive appointing numbers of tribunals of a quasi-judicial character. We find a large number of rules made by executive under law, regulating conduct of different kinds. In modern state, the executive enjoys certain powers of legislation as well of deciding disputes." So what he says is that when you have these tribunals, it is really the executive which is administering justice now. You don't have any judiciary, much less an independent judiciary, which is doing it. And this, according to him, is extremely troublesome, as he warned us as early as 1949. And today, I mean, it's The challenge to independence of judiciary also comes from lack of funding by the executive. Our country has perhaps one of the lowest number of per capita judges in the world. Coupled with that, the infrastructure available to judiciary is dismal. Judges at all levels function in most trying situations. You know, if you go to, I don't know whether you have been to Mofuzil courts, small courts or not, but I many a times take up cases just to, you know, go around and see what happens in this court. You should see that the judge has virtually no place to sit. The courtroom is not, cannot be called a courtroom by any stretch of imagination. And when you ask the judge, you find that the judge travels in the same bus that the accused is traveling, who is going to appear before him. And it's really sad to see that judge has no stenographer to dictate. He writes by his hand, or his reader will write by hand an order. So, I mean, with this kind of system, and the executive is not willing to release the funds. Supreme Court has, you know, in the case which has been instituted by Advocate on Record Association, again and again issued mandamus to the government to release funds. It has helped to somewhat extent, but not nothing sufficient. So the position of judges is extremely sad. I was just addressing at the All India Judicial Academy in Bhopal a group of Sri Lankan judges who had come, and I was during lunch I was talking to them. I said, did you travel around in India? And they said, yes. So I said, how do you find the facilities for judges, subordinate? They were subordinate judges up to district judge level. They said, it's dismal. He said, our country offers far better, you know, facilities to judges than what you have. So a small country like, and we pride ourselves as, you know, as really one of the greatest countries in the world, with some 7% GDP and 33,000 rupees Bombay Stock Exchange and God knows what. So it's the in spite of interference by Supreme Court to improve judiciary's condition, the executive has not done much. Coupled with this is the burden of the caseload. We have 30 million cases pending. This affects the independence of judiciary to a great extent. Even if you come to Supreme Court on Mondays and Fridays, you will be ashamed. You will be actually ashamed. And when I was president of the bar 2 years ago, I told Chief Justice Thakur again and again that I find it extremely unacceptable the treatment that women lawyers and women litigants receive in the corridors of the Supreme Court. Because there is no place to walk. Everybody has to brush aside everybody else. It's not a very healthy thing, and this is Supreme Court of India. And I mean, we never had the vision to even create an infrastructure in Supreme Court of India which would, you know, serve us for 50 years, if not 100. So all courtrooms are, it is impossible to enter, it is impossible to get out. If you have number of cases which many successful seniors have, or Advocate on Record have, they run from one court to the other. It's so difficult, so difficult. So if this is what is in Supreme Court's, you know, condition, there is no parking space. There is no parking space. Many a times we find ourselves completely locked down because some lawyer has parked a car in the middle of the way. So you can't go to High Court if you have accepted a brief in High Court. It's this affects the independence of judiciary to a great extent, according to me. The appropriate institutional approach of the courts should discourage judges from acting in partisan or self-interested manner. Equally, conscientious decision makers also can cause harm, not because they seek an advantage for themselves, but because their sincere convictions are unjust or incompatible with the Constitution. Intellectual dishonesty is one of the biggest challenges for independence of judiciary. Brilliant judges, honest judges, but they look at, they take for example judges like Justice Desai, D.A. Desai, my mentor, outstanding judge, but in a dispute between landlord and tenant, tenant had to succeed. In a dispute between employer and employee, employee had to succeed. And he had no qualms about it. He would openly say, what's wrong, in his loud voice. Brilliant judge. Brilliant judge. My father never wanted me to be a lawyer because he was retiring. My father was a very good, respected High Court judge. But he didn't have the means to support me after his retirement, and I was still in college. But it was Justice Desai who told my father that this young boy won't need your help. Let him become a lawyer. So, but yet I feel that, you know, this kind of ideological judging of cases is so dangerous. Even today we have at least 3 or 4 judges who are so extremely right being oriented that it is very difficult for, you know, a citizen to get justice in their courts. Very difficult. And especially if you belong to a certain section of society, you just can't get justice before them. Which is not healthy at all. Accountability of judges is a must. Judicial independence and judicial accountability always go in different directions. More independent judges are less accountable, and more accountable judges are less independent. How to bridge this gap is a big challenge for this country. Bar and the civil society both can play a big role in this regard. Unfortunately, I must accept that bar is really, I think, at its lowest levels in this country. It's never been such a bad bar as we have today. But that's how it is. We have to accept it. Criticism of judges at work, not casual criticism, can be very effective in controlling the behavior and decisions of judges, resulting in greater independence. Equally, the judgments must be debated by civil society. The more light on the judiciary, the more independent it will be. The more it remains in dark, less independent it will be. How does the world look at judicial independence? The statement of principles of independence of judiciary, as adopted by the United Nations General Assembly, clearly provides inter alia as under: the independence of judiciary shall be guaranteed by the state and enshrined in the constitution or the law of the country. It is the duty of all governmental and other institutions to respect and observe the independence of judiciary. We are a signatory to this declaration. Another principle which has been accepted by UN is: it's the duty of each member state to provide adequate resources to enable judiciary to properly perform its functions. The Beijing Declaration, which was adopted by the 6th Conference of Chief Justices of Asia and Pacific, has a very beautiful: judiciary is an institution of the highest value in every society. The maintenance of independence of judiciary is essential to the attainment of its objectives and proper performance of its functions in a free society observing rule of law. It is essential that such independence be guaranteed by the state and enshrined in the constitutional law. In 2005, Parliament of United Kingdom introduced Constitutional Reform Act 2005 to make provisions about judiciary, their appointment and discipline. The Act contemplated creation of Judicial Appointments Commission, responsible for appointment of judges for English and Welsh courts purely on basis of merits. See Section 27 of that Act. Recently, an advertisement was issued by Supreme Court of United Kingdom inviting applications for the post of President of the Supreme Court. Public advertisement. No collegium, no president of, or no queen appointing. A public advertisement inviting application. And it says, exceptional legal understanding. What was the requirement? Exceptional legal understanding, stature and expertise, communication and leadership skills to lead the court through an increasingly complex judicial and constitutional environment where some of the essential qualifications prescribed therein. Is independent judiciary a myth or a reality in today's time is a question. The answer to this is very difficult, as I began saying. My own view is that it is more a myth than reality. Thank you very, very much.
Right, so we have about 10-15 minutes for questions. So if you'd like to ask a pointed question, please raise your hand. I'll identify you and...